Okay, actually the full title is even longer than that. It's Buddhist Existentialism at Play with Possibilities, a proposal for an environmentally sustainable vision of the good life and philosophical remedy for our existential malaise. So, I suppose a good place for the existentialist to start would be the tragic look of life and reality. Rather than burying our heads in the sand, why don't we face up to it? Existentialists would say, face up to it, like perhaps the Buddha, or Nietzsche, or the Stoics, etc. Life certainly can seem to be pretty harsh, as you've probably noticed. Disenchanted, as many people say these days. No wonder T.S. Eliot observed that most folk live lives of quiet desperation. Or that so many in our society seem to be rather depressed, over-anxious, and overwrought, often overweight, too. Maybe we can go beyond blue, as they say, with some applied philosophical inquiry tonight. If stuck in the ordinary banal views, certainly, people might have a dose of the angst. Even if typically they like to pretend otherwise, for we do tend to gloss over it a lot, don't we? Focusing on relatively superficial things instead, our daily busyness, careers, the mass media, entertainments, internet social working, of course, nowadays, romance, etc. And so we do tend to evade the biggest issues in what existentialists call a kind of everyday and authentic self-deception, or the modern social lack of real philosophy, we could say. But escapism, of course, is a rather shallow palliative. The basics remain, and remain disturbing: impermanence, insecurity, conflicts, pain, suffering, violence, illness, loneliness, aging, death, the loss of love, the horrors of history, the gnawing fears. Have I missed anything out? Fill in the gaps, as you please. However, we can learn from philosophy to critique ordinary worldviews and take more philosophical ownership of the world in which we live. Consider Max Stirner in this regard. Our critical power, Epictetus, ancient Stoic, would say that is our main resource here. The special virtue of the rational animal, Homo sapiens, the power of sweet reason. Suck on the sweets of sweet philosophy, said Shakespeare. Be more rational. Not, however, in the sense of so-called worldly prudence, itself based on many dubious assumptions, but as wisdom, having the wit to deconstruct the world, this cruel world or modern reality that tends to trouble us so. After all, for all we know, any so-called reality, whether religious or secular, could be a trick, a simulation, or a con, a comprehensive deception. Remember The Matrix. You've all seen that movie. You good? We could be in one, a Matrix world, for all we know. We wouldn't know if we were. If we simply buy into so-called reality without using our critical powers philosophically, then it does tend to become a kind of fixated self-deception. Well, why buy into any of the idols of the past? saw disconnect now with your hand out there, so I'm on point one, time to tackle time. Why buy into any of the idols of the past? The question applies to every worldview, I would suggest, whether Jewish or Christian or Muslim, Hindu, Buddhist, modern, materialist, atheist, etc., etc., etc. In fact, when I present ontology to students at RMIT, they don't like any of the standard worldviews, traditional worldviews, which is actually maybe not too surprising, because they do appear a bit simplistic, dogmatic, pessimistic usually, limiting and limited. So rather than present any one final fixed worldview as the final truth of things, it might be more philosophically authentic, in the Socratic sense, to present a more open-ended view grounded in nothingness, no-thingness. Thus become the deconstructive player and owner of views. Play with the various language games, as postmoderns would say. That is, be at play with the possibilities. Well, let's be considering this hypothesis that the cure for our existential malaise is a daily practice of philosophical meditation, an awareness that deconstructs to zero, so to speak. One can learn to critique and even void so-called reality, thereby disempowering it. I take back its alienated power over me. I touch it with the Zen-like sword, diamond sword of wisdom or insight, and the idol of reality shatters. So one might learn to say from a Zen-like point of view. Here's an example. Say the past depresses you, the horrors of history, etc. Well then, we can always negate and void the past contemplatively. Take back its alienated power over you. Make it as nothing and thereby nothing much to you. After all, for all we know, seriously, it might never have existed. Or not in the way we think. For all we know, we could have been born or created this very morning. I'm just way out enough as a philosopher to contemplate such possibilities. The past could be naught but a trick, a banal fantasy, a nightmare, or a nostalgia trip. The good old days cliché comes to mind, or the golden age illusion. Or alternatively, we have the Dark Ages cliché, or the tragic world history cliché, and so on. Another example, say the future scares you. Well then, we can learn to negate and void the future. Take back its alienated power over you. Make it as nothing and thereby nothing to you. After all, for all we know, it may never happen. Somewhat as in the movie Groundhog Day. Seen that one too, I suppose. We could, for all we know, be living the same day over and over again. Well, it's possible, so we should keep our minds open to that. There might never be a tomorrow, in fact. Never mind Macbeth's tomorrow and tomorrow and tomorrow. So the point is this. We seem to be merely projecting in any moment of awareness a story of linear time, of yesterday and tomorrow, spooking ourselves like a child with it, like the bogeyman under the bed, perhaps. Or alternatively, we could say of anything that seems bad in the past or future that it could actually be a necessary stepping stone to something far better in the future, still to come. Our situation is surely completely open-ended, after all. In short, how about we get really philosophical and question even the so-called reality of time, or linear time? See how to deconstruct that to zero, a Zen-like singular moment of meditative awareness, a unique singularity, this mysterious here and now immediacy. There need be no definite past or future, given past or future. Who says they exist? They are surely not sacred authorities, are they? Ah, but what if your own mind says they exist? I now hear you ask. Well then, why not take proper philosophical ownership of your mind? Why permit yourself to be owned by it? That is, enthralled by some kind of fixed idea or dogma. Why not make your mind your servant rather than be its servant? Why not master your mind with some philosophy, in other words? After all, we can learn to critique in fully Socratic fashion all knowledge claims as being merely dubious. Take ownership then of all the old idols, for example, the past and the future and other such so-called sacred truths. Why must we let ourselves be limited in our philosophical powers here and now by the merely apparent reality of things? Instead, we could put up a fight. We could learn to meditate, for example, above time. Get over it. Let go of time. Which would also imply let go of yourself. Mr. Buddha said, when we void egocentrism, separate temporal ego and its temporal affairs, life tends to begin to seem well in and of itself. Naturally green in the singular moment, a sudden incredible appearance to itself, a mysterious singularity in which we can learn to be at play with possibilities philosophically, including even the maximally positive possibilities. After all, nothing is sacred except by my bending the knee. So said that remarkable, much maligned and misunderstood philosopher, Max Stirner. Idols abound, but we can subvert them, as Stirner and Nietzsche and others have shown. From robotic habit, unfortunately, we tend to backslide if we become distracted, as tends to happen every other moment of the day, as you may have noticed. So, for example, one easily gets tricked by the mind back into time. For example, concerned about how things have been for you in the past or how things will go for you in the future and so on. We may even slip into the mistake of thinking of how things will go for us in the future now that we are armed with this new philosophy that voids time. So tricky is the mind. Point two, then, on your sheet, so-called practical life. But surely we have to live in the ordinary world and function practically here. I now hear you say. Well, okay. But we can learn to take it with a pinch of salt, as it were, story-wise or ironically. See, it is only the apparent temporal reality of life, and be able to criticize it or critique it to its philosophical suspense, as the ancient Pyrrhonian skeptics would have said. Learn how to let go of everything. All that solid melts into the air, as they say. The solid was only an assumption, after all. Practicality is such an assumption, although our modern time and efficiency managers would like us to believe it is the sacred truth itself. They would make an idol out of it and a slave out of us in the process. But we can be the hammers of every idol, as Nietzsche would have put it. For example, we can revolt and see this, that there's no given so-called practical world, because the practical, or what counts as practical, is surely a relative term in a language game, and pragmatism a kind of modern dogma, a story. But a story ossified into a taken-for-granted cliché that some people, lots of people, call the truth. An example of this, many claim that philosophy is impractical, while so-called vocational courses are practical. I hear this a lot at RMIT. Hence they are better, more worthwhile, etc. However, the vocational courses seem to do little to cure our existential malaise or liberate us from the fetters and idols of this world. For example, the unsustainable consumerist vision of the good life. Such courses rather tend to lock us further into our busy lives of wasteful consumption, with angst lurking just beneath the surface. So one could just as soon argue that philosophy is perhaps the most practical subject in the curriculum, if it can be a remedy for our civilization and its discontents. Perhaps we've all been conned by the idea of prudence, when maybe it's more prudent to be able to avoid the prudent. After all, how else are we to get a proper break from everything? A release, a true holiday, not the wasteful consumerist kind on Hamilton Island, etc. We have to play in the reality game, of course, but it's also good to be able to take time out from it. But surely there is still old age, relentless loss and death. I know you say. But let's ask, what is death anyway? If we don't know the future exists, then we don't know that death exists. Or even if it does, we don't know what it means. Could be a boon in disguise, for all we know. Or a gateway to a world beyond our current comprehension, which could be pretty interesting. For all we know, it could be waking up to a better reality compared to which this life might seem like a comparative nightmare. So that's another thing we should keep our minds open to. For who knows? Then, if we live in the authentic philosophical moment, we would be voiding our standard cultural prejudices, returning to zero, as it were. And even so-called death need not be a problem then. Even this so-called old age business, what is that if there's no sacred linear time? Then there's no such thing as getting old. I keep telling people who tell me I'm getting old. There's no such thing. That, too, is just a cliché of our culture, a prejudicial idea repeated in a modern language game. As is dismissing old folks as somehow inferior to young folks, or vice versa. A person could, surely, just as soon say, I am in my prime today, and apply that to every day and any age. Today is a good day to die, the Sioux Indians used to say. Well, it's also a good day to live in your prime. Part 3, artistic seduction. Well, arts, we need to watch out, keep our wits about us. Don't be fooled, for example, by movies. They tend to spook us, that is, to manipulate our sensibilities into making us think and emote in particular ways. We're easily spellbound into some, what, tragic feeling, or horrified feeling, or that sinking feeling. Or alternatively, some feel-good Hollywood movie ending, of course. Sheer trickery. But this sort of thing goes on in the media all the time. One is presented with a limited world from one culture's point of view, typically the Western one, of course. And then this gets reinforced over and over, or hyper-realized, as the guru of postmodernism, Jean Baudrillard, would say. Even movies about the past are from a modern point of view on the past. So one can never access it accurately, assuming that it even existed. Even movies that claim to be historical are unhistorical. Here's a thought. Representation is selection. Selection is distortion. Therefore, representation is misrepresentation. Moreover, even if so-called past people existed, one cannot see things through their eyes or understand what was practical for them from their point of view, from their world of experience. For example, ancient Romans or medieval peasants or samurai women, perhaps, cannibals, and so on. Ontology, too, is like a kind of art, a seduction, linguistically skewed realities. Well, we could buy into it for some emoting, perhaps, temporarily, as in a theatre, but also be able to critique it as well. So, maybe go with the flow of a movie, for example, up to a point, or likewise play along with the modern Australian worldview up to a point. No need to be fettered or fooled by it, as if it's the truth itself. Thus, we need not set our affair on anything or any one view. For after all, there are many amazing possibilities to play with in philosophy. Indeed, a new infinity of them, Nietzsche says at one point in chapter 1 of Beyond Good and Evil. Part 4, philosophical irony. Thus, we might, in effect, learn to be more ironic with texts and with our goals in life, and even with the so-called world or reality, and with oneself. That would mean, although we are saying and doing something on the surface of life every day, underneath we are also saying and doing the virtual opposite, namely, zero critique of all that, the Zen-like voidance of it all. So the Socratic type, surely, is necessarily a great ironist. As Socrates himself was, according to Plato, even in the face of an unjust execution. For what is that exactly? What is just and what is unjust? Another complicated question. These two are relative terms in limited language games. We can learn to take philosophical ownership of all such terms, either to use them positively in our preferred play of possibilities or preferred language games, or else dissolve them again in their nothingness or in the void? If so, we're essentially at play in the world, philosophizing with possibilities, which I would suggest is, in effect, the examined life in everyday action. As Socrates said, of course, famously, the unexamined life is not worth living. Why? Because it's a dubious, ossified, closed, cliché-ridden life of temporal conventionalities. We might like to add nowadays that it is also environmentally unsustainable. More on this in a minute. There's no idol that cannot be sounded out and shattered, it seems. For example, God, romantic love, family ties, world religions, modern ideologies, scientific worldviews even, time and space, the soul, egocentrism, dualism, the belief in separate entities, and Western individualism, all the old ideas and ideologies. Being at play with possibilities, we do not even have to take so-called other minds or the so-called material world or even one's so-called person too seriously. Words and ideas are more like toys we are playing with then that can be also put back in the toy box. Indeed, even put the toy box back in the toy box. You can get your head around that idea. Part 5. Philosophy love. It follows that the philosopher will have a rather unique kind of love or passion. Not any of the conventional loves. For example, romantic love, family love, God-centered love, moralistic love, or any kind of hedonistic consumer love. But philosophy love. That is, it is simply philosophia, the love of wisdom. Wisdom being the passion to examine life every minute. The love of being at play with possibilities in every minute. Note this too, as this love is not dependent on any one external stimulus, for example, a lover or a consumer item, and so on. It's not limited to this or that person, family, place, thrills, or particular goods. Philosophy thereby subverts modern romanticism and modern consumerism, or the entire consumerist good life love idolatry. Philosophy love, after all, is free. Indeed, it is freedom, self-sourced as wisdom. It is self-reliant and self-sufficient. It costs nothing. It's Scotsman's dream. It can be present daily. It comes from within and is expressed without, so it can, in principle, be unlimited. It can be expressed towards everything and everybody. In short, it's a universal kind of love rather than a love that is so narrow and limited that it is merely for example, one's so-called partner or one's family or nation or idol or what about gold ring of power, my precious? Or for that matter, one's personal so-called self, or self-identity over time, and its dubious temporal self-interest in the world. So we can learn to take philosophical ownership of love and life. Otherwise, love and life is likely to take ownership of us, like a dependency, or an addiction, or an attachment. A situation so decadent and unstable it might well be called neurotic. For example, being a shopaholic, or a workaholic, perhaps, or a thrilloholic, etc. Nietzsche would probably put it that in our slave morality culture, we instinctively look for and soon put ourselves into new fetters and chains. For example, modern romance and wasteful consumption. We tend to flee from freedom and mastery. That is, in effect, people evade philosophy. If there is a dishonesty and cowardice relative to our essential species virtue, hence something that could be called inauthentic, that is surely it. The flight from philosophy, the quick slide back into banal, conventional, everyday life. Actually, most students accomplish this within 2 minutes of leaving the lecture theatre. The means for it is in their hands. It's called a mobile. Okay, but how do we get to positive love from negative critique? I now hear you ask. Well, love like beauty is in the eye of the beholder. It's our cultural prejudice that creates the unlovable. Philosophical critique tends to void cultural prejudice. Kind of unclogs and frees up the arteries of the mind, enabling a freer flow of positive energy and magnanimous goodwill to entertain the most positive of all possibilities. That everything and everyone is somehow or other right and good, hence lovable, even if we do not know and cannot comprehend how or why it is. Well, we could perhaps all be God, or Buddha, always already, or Brahman, perhaps, playing a virtual reality world theater game, for all any of us here knows. So why don't we play with that kind of amazing possibility more often, instead of the more banal ones that we find in our usual texts? What perhaps dismays philosophers the most, if I may put it this way, with all due respect, is that we are rather second-hand people, cliché-ridden minds, culturally curtailed. Well, it's not our fault, though. It's just what the tribal conditioning tends to do to us. It narrows the mind with opinions handed down the generations to make us fit in and be functional in a small parochial context. So it gives us a kind of tunnel vision. Meanwhile, the actual context of life is something huge, open-ended, unlimited, and impenetrably mysterious. It's a kind of contextless context. Contextless context. Kind of like the so-called Tao that can't be spoken. Beyond words, beyond explanations, and possess beyond texts or contexts. Philosophy aims to smash any ingrained ideologies to open us up better to life without prejudice, and thereby enable a more magnanimous, enlarged mind and goodwill towards what is
as it is, as it unfolds, nothing excluded. The enlarged or enlightened passion is to affirm, enjoy, and love it all. The pleasures and pains, all the seeming or relative good and bad that happens, taking it all in as part of the one comprehensive good that we call the examined life, from a Socratic point of view. Note that philosophy love is not only more reliable, because rooted in wisdom and character, relatively independent of externals, it's even in principle a kind of invisible love, a kind of invincible love. How so? Because even the so-called bad that may arise, for example, bad feelings, of course, that crop up, blue moods, weakness, anger, panic, etc., etc., is taken up and integrated into the good, hence into the lovable. So even if this love were to fail for a time, it would be successfully renewed in the act of integrating that failure back into the love. Essentially, then, it cannot be defeated. We learn to bounce back, in other words, and the more we do this, the quicker it can become. So, I would suggest that the true philosopher is not like the person in that old Simon and Garfunkel song who sings, "I am a rock, I am an island, and a rock feels no pain, and an island never cries." Rather, we say, "I'm not a rock, but I am resilient. I'm not an island, but I have insight." A resilient person can feel panic or pain, all right, maybe cries at times, but soon recovers and laughs inwardly again. True health is not to be measured by how long we go without ever getting panicked or wounded or ill, but rather is to be measured by how long recovery takes. Philosophy health is how long it takes us to regain our good wits and our good spirits. That is our essential eudaimonia, as the ancient Greeks called it, eudaimonia, being in a good spirit from within. And regain our essential arete, as they called it, wisdom, excellence, virtue. Okay, that takes us to part six. Philosophy is the joyful wisdom. Philosophy meditation is enlightenment, I would suggest. Enlightenment is enlargement of mind, broadness and openness, being big enough to love everything. We don't defer to any small sacred worldview, any religious creed, atheism or materialism, etc., or seek the closure of the inquiring mind in such ways. Rather, we leave it all open, hence properly Socratic, that is, incisively philosophical. Meanwhile, we can decisively elect to love and rejoice in all as it is. That, then, is the joyful wisdom, to use a Nietzsche title. Is it simply Nietzsche, then, that I'm talking about? Well, no, not quite. Nietzsche approved of loving fate, amor fati, he called it, as the innocence of becoming, he called it. However, although he wrote about the twilight of the idols, one of these titles, there is one idol, though, that he did not sound out sufficiently with his hammer, it seems, namely
time.
Perhaps because he was so caught up in becoming. That is, evolution and the eventual coming of the so-called Übermensch. He didn't manage to void the arrow of time towards a goal, it seems. Somewhat ironically, this looking out for an ideal something to come that will redeem the past actually sounds all too Christian for this great anti-Christian. Time, indeed, is a key dogma in Western culture, no doubt due to Christianity, what with its second coming scenarios, and also later to the influence of major philosophers like Hegel and Heidegger, and of course, people like Darwin. It has been said that Western culture is logocentric, that is, addicted to logos, that is, to words, theories, analysis, explanations, etc., texts. However, we could just as soon say it is chronocentric, addicted to time. Emphasis is placed on history, evolution, and the telos, or the end of things. Even in deconstructive postmodernism, we're still being advised by Jacques Derrida, for example, to focus on the future, waiting on what is to come, as he puts it, one of his favorite phrases. Turn far east, though, to Zen, and we find time annulled, as is all duality, that is, belief in separate things and time. Separate things and separate times. In Zen, emptiness, also called mu or shunyata, duality is dissolved in non-dual awareness of the singular moment. Attachment to time, to everything temporal, is dropped. We go light in a kind of timeless void in this state. We lighten up about things. There is a joyful wisdom where we are free to play with the possibility that the real is the ideal. Even if we don't know and do not need to know how or why it is. After all, that we do not know and cannot explain it can also be affirmed as ideal. How things should be in the one good whole, for all we know. We can rejoice in that, along with everything else. We have, in short, arrived at an ode to joy, or Jeej, an ode to joy. There is, all of a sudden, such a thing as an authentic existential joy in life. Not mere management of angst, as existentialists and existential psychotherapists would say. Rather, full-on joyful wisdom. Joy in nothingness, needing no reason. It being without why, on the other side of reason, that is, post-rational. It is the joy of the free-spirited heart, rather than the critical head, matter of the heart, rather than the head. But where the critical head is an essential prerequisite for this free-spirited heart. So neither head nor heart needs to be denied here. We might sum the matter up with this motto from Zen master Shunryu Suzuki Roshi. From true emptiness, wondrous being. From true emptiness, wondrous being. Now, if or when we have this wondrous being, this sense of it, this free love, beauty, and philosophical joy, here, there, and everywhere, then life can be truly re-enchanted. And that, in a nutshell, is what I mean by Buddhist existentialism, the dubious title of my book. Unfortunately, I just sold the last copy a little while ago. Part 7 to finish. Our environmental responsibility to be joyful philosophers. Well, this is also what I mean by the environmentally responsible and sustainable good life. Only if humanity can learn how to abide in the joyful wisdom, that is, in a meditative joy that does not depend on chasing around like a slave after distractions and idols, wastefully consuming various fancy goods and services, or people and places, or romantic or exotic experiences, etc., etc., can we maybe hope that our species might learn to cease squandering the Earth's limited resources and generally abusing the environment in our so-called pursuit of happiness? As the Zen saying goes, we can learn how to sit quietly doing nothing, a meditative state. And while doing nothing, grasping at nothing from the environment, needing nothing, abide in an empathic mind of joyful wisdom. If so, this would surely be the ethical and wise form of the good life, and perhaps the arete, the eudaimonia, that we badly need today. Do nothing to achieve everything is apparently an old Chinese saying we had on the TV a couple of weeks ago. Actually, sounds quite right to me. However, people today seem hell-bent on doing something, producing and consuming, thus using up the environment to service a great many needless pursuits. This incredibly wasteful consumption is referred to as the modern consumer good life, the temporal pursuit of happiness, and we're sold it by the media day in, day out. Indeed, we were taught it and taught to be like slaves from day one in our pursuit of happiness. Let's ask, however, can there really be a temporal pursuit of happiness at all? Is philosophy, perhaps, a way to pursue it in time? How about no? No to both questions. Rather, the more we pursue happiness, the more we tend to push it away from us into the future, and so deflect it, postpone it. Because happiness, eudaimonia, actually more like joy, is accessed timelessly within, non-temporally, that is, as a kind of immediate wisdom or enlightenment. Philosophy, then, is not to be confused with the pursuit of happiness. Philosophy is happiness. However, as we've noted, philosophy usually gets dismissed nowadays as a useless discipline, for example, at RMIT, even although RMIT also has sustainability as part of its mission statement, which might just be for PR reasons. Now, there's an aporia or self-contradiction, surely. But hey, it seems we're living in a topsy-turvy land. No wonder that the planet doesn't seem to stand much chance. Finally, in conclusion then, to abide in authentic philosophical moments of awareness, and so live in the Socratic joyful wisdom, and to bring that joyful wisdom into our interpersonal relationships, and into our actions in the world, so that our actions become more ironic and playful, this might be viewed now as being as much an ethical, environmental, sustainability requirement as a personal happiness requirement. Arete, or excellence, is environmentally sustainable eudaimonia, I'm suggesting. A kind of inner flourishing, naturally green, which is going to be the title of my next book, Naturally Green. A kind of evergreen joy in every fresh moment of this awareness. And the future of the planet may well depend on people learning this. I've probably babbled on long enough.
So how do you propose we, given that we're so entrenched with respect to time in work, we even to come here, we have to come with respect to time, how do you propose we can apply a philosophy given that there's so much dependency on time?
Yes, of course it's very difficult, as you say, because our society is so time-centered. Not just time-centered, but also centered on various other idols that I was suggesting we need to free our minds from. So how do we free our minds from all those idols? Well, by practicing philosophy every day. By meditating every day would be something I would recommend. So paradoxically, by setting some time aside to meditate, setting some time aside to philosophize, setting some time aside to take time out from this busy life scenario that we're usually caught up in. It's not impossible to do, I think. I mean, it's difficult to do because of all the pressures and so on on us. But if you stop and think about it, it's not impossible to do. For example, to find time to meditate. You may be walking to work, you may be on the train. There's all sorts of odd moments during the day that you might take 5 minutes or 10 minutes out to meditate. Instead of watching the TV so much, people might get together with friends to have a philosophy jam or go to Fanny's philosophy cafe and discuss philosophy, and so bring their minds back to this kind of stuff. Bring it back from the distractions that tend to enthrall us so much. If we let ourselves go into that banal habit of everyday life, it tends to suck us in. Yeah? Before you know it, you're caught up more and more in it. So, how do you break a bad habit? Same as any other bad habit. You have to become very aware of it, catch yourself doing it every time you do it, and decide resolutely to stop and do something else. So breaking bad habits is difficult. You know, if you've got a cigarette habit or something like that, it's difficult to break, but not impossible. So I suggest it's basically the same as that, and you just have to be resolved enough to do it. Focus on philosophy, focus on meditation, focus on these ideas, and refuse to be caught up so much in the daily grind.
Can I respond to that? I guess from a work perspective, and let's say if you're a student, you're tied to go to lectures at specific times, you're tied to go to meetings at certain times, you're tied to get to certain events at certain times. So how do you, it almost seems like to really break that habit, you have to dislocate yourself from that whole construct.
I don't think you have to dislocate yourself entirely, but yes, you do have to be resolute about stepping back from it and making some time to contemplate time, or make some time to break free of the habits of every Venus. Philosophers have been saying that since, since the beginning. Since Socrates. And most people have complained, how do we do this? We've got our busy lives and so forth. But dedicated people are generally able to make the time. I've tended to find that if people are resolute enough, they will find the time, because they will give up other things that are now of less priority, which might be the TV or movies or socializing or some other thing.
Okay. Yep. You brought up the idea of Übermensch or overman, Nietzsche's thing. I find that quite intriguing. I just want to ask you what you think that means, whether it means just attaining a sort of state of mind, or if it actually is a physical evolution into something different, whether through natural selection or technological enhancements.
Yes, there's a few different interpretations of that, certainly. There has been some tradition of interpreting it as being that kind of physical evolution, futuristic idea, that we gradually work towards this kind of evolutionary ideal that might happen 200 or 300 years down the track. That's one possible way to interpret Nietzsche's idea, but I actually don't agree with that interpretation myself. Because I think there's quite a lot there in Nietzsche that suggests, for example, he says quite clearly in Ecce Homo that his formula for greatness in a human being is amor fati, love of fate here and now. Now, if that's his formula for greatness, and the Übermensch is the great human being, then surely the criteria for the Übermensch is amor fati. And this is an internal, this is a spiritual or internal or mental state, philosophical state, that one can arrive at through the twilight of the idols. So if a person can engage in the twilight of the idols and can then choose to affirm the totality of existence, the totality of nature, the totality of fate from moment to moment, then they would have amor fati, then they would be the Übermensch, and so the Übermensch, I think, is a real here and now possibility, not some futuristic goal. Well, I would take that kind of interpretation of the Übermensch. It's basically the yes-saying individual who feels totally at one with the unfolding innocence of becoming that is nature. Possibly going a slight step further, if you identify Dionysus with nature, it would be becoming one with Dionysus. So it really would be Dionysus versus the crucified. That's the last thing that appears in the book, the last sentence. Have I been understood? Dionysus versus the crucified. Dionysus is the god of nature, so oneness with that. So where that oneness, that would be the Übermensch, in my view.
Is that not the Superman?
Yes, that has been translated as the Superman, but the preferred translation usually these days is the Overman. But neither translation is very good, I don't think. It might be best just to leave it as the Übermensch.
So why do you call it the love of fate?
Because he says that's his formula for greatness in a human being, and the Übermensch is supposed to be his image of the great human being. Or the greater human being. So the Übermensch would be the person of amor fati in that case. That would be how I would interpret it.
Good, thank you.
You used some of the postmodern theory in your talk tonight. I'm just wondering where you sit with postmodern. There's been some benefits with postmodern, but also the extreme forms of postmodern, deny reality altogether. I'm just wondering where you sit with that, because, for instance, the idea of progress. If you compare Victorian England to now, as Charles Dickens portrayed Victorian England, quite accurate, actually, there has been some progress in comparison to those times where, for instance, 90% of the children die under the age of 5 in workhouses. We don't have those sorts of
things. Yes, well, I'm going to stick my neck out here. I'm probably getting chopped off, but I go all the way with postmodernism.
You go all the way.
So, terms like progress would have to be like any other term, a relative term in a language game. And the concept of progress could only be measured relative to some cultural language game. And some other culture might not agree with what we think progress is. For example, if you are playing a full-on fundamentalist Christian language game, you might not accept that we've progressed recently. Our scientific culture, from their point of view, might be regarded as regress, not progress, because it's leading more and more people astray. So the concept of progress is going to depend on what your overall worldview is, just like the concept of practicality depends on what your overall worldview is. And that's a big question. What establishes the truth of an overall worldview? I don't think we can establish the truth of an overall paradigm or overall worldview. They're like different incommensurable paradigms. There's no way that a fundamentalist Christian could ever agree with a person who's got a scientific paradigm or vice versa.
Isn't there an implicit worldview in your worldview?
Well, not so much a worldview as a kind of approach to worldviews, which is to recognize their relativity and to recognize that they can be deconstructed and that we cannot establish which of the worldviews are correct. And that was a central theme in the whole talk, actually. The Socratic position being that we can challenge any knowledge claims, all knowledge claims, and that we ultimately know nothing. So, people will say that postmodernism is this new thing that's come along that's, you know, anarchic or disturbing or unsettling. But in fact, if you look at Socrates or if you look at the Pyrrhonian skeptics, they were saying similar things way back 2,000 years ago or more. So I don't think it's necessarily all that new. Basic idea is not new. Maybe new things in it is the particular stress on language, perhaps, and text and discourse, that type of thing. But the underlying theme of the impossibility of establishing a real truth or objective truth or absolute truth or correct worldview is not new.
But Socrates was religious. He believed in God. I mean, he...
Well, that depends on your...
And so Plato, depends, the real world and the real real, the real and the really real.
Depends on how you view Socrates. Now, scholars are a bit divided on this because, I mean, we don't have anything from Socrates himself. We get it from Plato, or we get a bit from Aristotle, or we get a bit from Xenophon, and so on. The main source, of course, is Plato. Now, many scholars are of the view that the most likely correct or historically accurate view of Socrates is probably the first thing that Plato wrote about Socrates and represented Socrates in, and that was the Apology, which was supposed to be the account of what Socrates said at his trial, and was written not long after it. Now, in the Apology, the Socrates in the Apology is very much a skeptic, because that's the bit, if you remember, where he says, my friend Chaerephon went off to the Delphic Oracle and asked the Delphic Oracle, who's the wisest man in Greece? And the Delphic Oracle said, Socrates, and this puzzled me, he says, Socrates, because I didn't think I had any knowledge or wisdom to speak of. So with a view to trying to find out what the oracle meant by this, I resolved to go around the streets of Athens and talk to all the people that claimed to have knowledge and try to learn from them or question them and find out if they really had this knowledge or not. And in the process of doing that, he found that they didn't have the knowledge that they claimed to have, because their arguments always contain some kind of logical fallacies or jumps or assumptions or something. So he ends up in the Apology saying that if he is the wisest man in Greece, his wisdom consists solely of this, that while other people claim to know what they don't know, he at least doesn't. So, the implication of that, I take, is that Socrates was quite the skeptic, and the initial dialogues, the early dialogues of Plato, tend to end on a skeptical note where some question is raised, and then it's queried by Socrates, and it's kind of left hanging there. And that fits with the idea that maybe the historical Socrates was quite the skeptic. The Pyrrhonian skeptics were a major philosophical school, lasting 600 years from the time of Socrates to about the 3rd century or so. And they took their cue from Socrates, and they believed that he was a skeptic like them. Even Plato's Academy, although initially it was quite metaphysical along Platonic lines, within the space of a generation became a school of skepticism, academic skepticism. So, for about 600 years or so, you had Pyrrhonian skeptics, you had academic skeptics as major competitors to your Aristotelian schools and your Stoic schools. So, a good case could be put for Socrates being a full-on skeptic. Back to the chair.
Sorry, you spoke of smashing the idol, so specifically part six, smashing the idol at the time. But prior to
what
the environmental sustainability
and
responsibility,
have you
not
put in place
the
other time we have to respect? No, what I'm suggesting is that we still have to act in the world. We still have to pursue goals, our prepared goals. But if we are rooted in this capacity to avoid everything, in this meditative, contemplative state, this Zen-like kind of state, then our action in the world becomes much more ironic and playful. But we still have our prepared goals. And one of those goals can be, and arguably should be, environmental sustainability. And therefore, we should be pursuing, or I would certainly hope that more people would pursue environmental sustainability as a prepared goal, but they should pursue it in a playful, ironic way, not in a dogmatic, ideologically driven kind of way, where they very easily get uptight and self-righteous and so on about things. So, it's just, on the action side, it's about taking a more playful approach to things, rather than a dogmatic approach to things. But we still act.
Not all of us share the postmodern notion that truth does not exist. Certainly, I contend that truth presents a falsified statement that exists in a variety of ontological diverse forms. For example, objectively falsifiable statements, subjectively falsifiable statements, hypothetically falsifiable statements, which are mathematical statements, who knows, perhaps even metaphysically falsifiable statements. So, can you be certain that the statement the nirvana of Siddhartha Gautama is the annihilation, or more likely, the coming to stillness of the intentional self and its unconscious and its unconscious foundations will have neural correlates, is not falsifiable?
Can I be sure it's not falsifiable? Is that the question? I'd be inclined to suppose that it's not falsifiable. You mean in a Popperian sense, falsifiable scientifically, empirically?
Yes, it can have to be falsifiable.
Probably can't be falsified then empirically, because what we'd have to have a time machine or something to go back and see the Buddha and check him out or something.
It doesn't.
So I'm not sure it's falsifiable.
Nirvana is not a possibility for modern people.
And suggesting that the kind of state that I was describing in the lecture, if you want to call that a state of nirvana, is a possibility for people to attain.
So are you contending that that has no neural correlates?
Has no what, sorry?
No neural correlates?
Neural correlates. Maybe it does. If
perhaps the intentional
if the brain exists.
Then maybe it does. Maybe it does have neural correlates if the brain exists. But for all I know, the brain doesn't exist. For all I know, the material world doesn't exist.
Well, I mean, you can take either metaphysical standpoint that the subjective is an effect of the brain, or you can take the solipsistic point of view that the brain is a correlate of subjective experience. I don't think that is too much itself.
Right, well, that's sort of like what I'm suggesting. You can take these different possibilities. Yeah, they're possible.
I'm contending that the truth does exist, so there's obviously quite a distinct difference between me and...
Now, hang on a moment. A minute ago, you were suggesting that a solipsist view was just as possible as a materialist view.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, if we don't know which of those two views is correct, how can we establish any truth about so-called neural correspondence or whatever it was you were talking about? If it's possible that solipsism is true, how can we establish any other truth?
How can you decide? I mean, to me, a standpoint is simply that. It means that there's two possibilities. They're not, I mean...
More than two.
Well, there could be
at least two.
At least two, yeah.
Yeah. In fact, I would suggest many possibilities. Many possibilities. And given that there are these many possibilities, it becomes impossible to establish a truth.
Well, it's meaningless to talk about.
So given that, I'm puzzled as to why you believe that there is a truth.
And a standpoint is precisely this. A theory can be falsified, or a standpoint, by definition, is a variety. It has to be, I mean, surely that's what you mean. You're saying, well, you know, there's a variety of possibilities. It's not, you know, they can't be, if one of them could be falsified, then there wouldn't be a variety of possibilities.
Yes. So one of the things I'm suggesting is that when it comes to major paradigm worldviews, they can't be falsified. And since that's the case, and since you seem to agree with that, I'm puzzled as to why you also hold the view that there is real objective truth and that we can establish what it is.
Why not?
Because if there are all these different possibilities, wouldn't that undermine our capacity to establish that one of them is the truth?
Either it's a theory that's falsifiable, or it's a standpoint, and there's a variety of possibilities. You obviously, by definition, you cannot falsify a standpoint. It's not a standpoint if you can. If you the standpoint that the subjective is an outcome of the objective, or it is one, and then another standpoint is that the objective is a correlate of the subjective. For you to suggest that one of them can be falsified...
I didn't suggest it could be falsified.
I think you were saying you're finding difficulty with me suggesting these two possibilities as a standpoint. You were saying, well...
I think if I'm hearing you correctly, we're in agreement that none of these major paradigms of worldviews can be falsified.
The standpoints can't be falsified by definition. The
worldviews.
The theories. Can't be falsified, yes.
Okay, I'm suggesting that the theories can't be falsified.
I can.
The Christian theory can't be falsified.
Well, it's not a theory then.
Okay, Christian worldview can't be falsified.
Well, I mean,
I'll give you the word theory.
A worldview can include not only standpoints, but value judgments. As far as I know, value judgments cannot be falsified either.
Okay, so a worldview can't be falsified.
How?
I'm suggesting a worldview can't be falsified.
Well, I mean, it's a standpoint, yes. It's a standpoint, yes.
So if we're agreed that a worldview can't be falsified, are we?
Well,
then anything that you put up as being something that's established as a truth might be false from the standpoint of some other worldview which can't be falsified.
Well, No, it can't be a...
If it can't be falsified, then the thing that you're taking to be the truth can't be established as being the truth.
Look,
because it could be wrong from the standpoint of another worldview.
The standpoint of an elephant, a rabbit, is quite a small animal, but from the standpoint of an ant, a rabbit is quite a large animal. Now, they are not, how can you put it, they're not falsifiable theories. They are simply looking at something from different points of view. That's all.
Right. So these worldviews are looking at reality from different points of view. Different perspectives, Nietzsche would say. So what I'm suggesting is that we have a whole variety of perspectives, a new infinity of them, Nietzsche says. And from these different perspectives, certain things will be called progress and certain things won't. And certain things will be called true and certain things won't. From these different perspectives. The perspectives are different in fundamental ways. And we can establish which of the perspectives are true, because they're not falsifiable or verifiable, for that matter.
Well, I mean, sometimes they're points of view, and they're simply alternatives. Sometimes they're value judgments, which are slightly different. I mean, I don't know how you got that.
I would suggest that there are value judgments implicit in all perspectives, in all worldviews.
Take the example of the elephant and the ant. There's no value judgment there.
I think we'll probably just have to chop that one now and maybe something else. I think you had a question. I think this probably would have to be the last one. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you all.
You'll let it go. Thank you. Okay, has anyone else got anything really pressing? Right, good. Thank you, Robert.
Okay, thank you, guys.